Hey guys, this week on Awesomecast, we got the Samsung Note 5 in the studio. Such a pretty, pretty phone, and I put so many selfies on there for Chilla. We talk about Periscope, we talk about Street View on your phone, Cat Street View, how are you using your phone, and so much more in advance of the Apple announcement. Check it out, Awesomecast. Find yourself in the Beachview area of Pittsburgh? Check out the official pizza of this show, Slice on Broadway, sharing an abnormal obsession with pizza we can relate to. Check them out at sliceonbroadway.com and tell them this show sent you. I'm getting awesome, you're getting awesome, we're getting awesome, yeah, that's what I said now. I'm getting awesome, you're getting awesome, we're getting awesome, yeah, that's what I said. Hey guys, it's the Awesomecast, this is episode 265, or as we stated, the 256th take. 65th. Son of a... I'm Mike Sorg, at Sorgatron on the Twitters here at the Mayhem Studios in Pittsburgh, PA. This is your awesome cast where we talk tech and have a little bit of a flyover state of mind and what we're using, what we're doing. I'm a dude that does video things and social media here and podcasty things, video. I said video. Oh, it's going to be one of those nights. Here in the Pittsburgh, PA area, also with me on the couch, our regulars. First of all, on your left if you're on the video version, or you can imagine him on your left if you're on the... No, our left. If you're on the audio version, he can swear ever. It can be behind you if it's an audio version. It's the theater of the mind. It's John Cicilla.
It's like reversed. I see. I make an L because I'm on the left, but I'm not on the left because I'm on the left over there, but I'm on the right over here.
Well,
but you're on my left.
Explain technology to us.
Hey, but we're only on the 265th take. We'll get it right at 56th.
wait, no, 65th.
Whatever. It's all numbers.
The numbers are in front of me. John Cicilla, he's a gadget extraordinaire. He does it for business things.
Business things.
That's right.
At the technology companies, but not really.
What?
I don't know.
Okay. Also with us, Katie Dudas, at Kay Dutters on the Twitter. She plays with zombies all day.
I play with my
life
is
going... Like toy zombies or real zombies?
Real life.
Don't get bitten.
She's the zombie wrangler extraordinaire and social media person.
For all kinds of crap.
Of note. For all kinds of things. Zombies, wrestling.
This says I do social medias for all kinds of crap. What would you like to know about? What interests you?
I actually still have in your title that you're fresh from the beach. That's very not accurate.
Fresh from the beach.
We'll get rid of that. Should be on the beach,
not in real life here.
There
with
you go.
People.
But this is the Awesomecast. You can find out more about us over at awesomecast.net. You can subscribe to us on the iTunes, the iHeartRadios, the YouTubes, the Facebooks, and all of that. Follow us on the Twitter, at Awesomecast on there, and the Facebook as well. And then we're putting some of the videos up there, so you can catch a little bit of that as well. Also, you can drop us a line to awesomecast@sorgatronmedia.com if you have any questions, if you have any gadgets you think are cool, or your awesome things of the week, and you can let us know on Twitter as well. And also, you can support us over on patreon.com/awesomecast, as does Thistle C Business Development. We're actually going to have a meeting with our Patreon. We're going to enjoy some of that great Slice on Broadway. I recommended the Gonzo here. I'm not Katie. I'm still Katie. We'll get rid of that.
Everyone is me.
But meeting with our Patreon supporters. Been supporting us for a couple months here. Thank you so much. You can become our boss, too. They get some special stuff. Like, I want to be discussing some businessy things over on the State of the Awesome cast that they get and nobody else does, unless you're putting a couple of pennies in there for the Patreon. So please go support that. Help the show grow. Your contributions are super, super appreciated around here. It helps try to keep the lights on and keep the podcast going. So we really do appreciate that. So we can't fuel on pizza alone, although it does, that also helps a great deal as well. So let's get into the awesome things of the week. Let's first get gadgety with Chilla. What do you got?
So, I have the Galaxy Note 5,
mm-hmm.
which looks much like the other Galaxies.
Wait, is this the one where you can turn it around the wrong way?
You can insert it wrong.
Yeah,
so it does have the stylus pen, S Pen.
Okay.
I will say, I'm actually very impressed with battery life, speed of the device, and the S Pen really makes me wonder, do I want an actual stylus for my iOS device? While you can put the pen in upside down, and they aren't 100% sure if that's going to be covered under warranty or not, and then it gets stuck and breaks the sensor, which would actually really bum me out. But one of the really cool features is if your phone's locked and you pull out the pen, you can actually take down a note while the phone's locked.
Mm-hmm.
Which I thought was pretty cool. Much like taking a photo from the camera, without unlocking the phone, you can actually take a quick note. Putting the pen back in will relock the device. The device does have the fingerprint sensor, much like the S5, S6 line. This being the Note 5, even though it's kind of more along the 6 genre.
Mm-hmm.
Typical micro USB on the bottom, headphones, speaker. I actually have used the camera quite often. One of the cool things that I found with the camera is you can actually broadcast to YouTube Live.
Oh, you're the one that gets that.
With a tap of a button.
You have my attention. Because this is one of those, because somebody was asking about, we were asking about live streaming like in a year from now something. And we're like, well, you realize YouTube Live will probably be on everybody's phone because it's on the Samsungs right now. Now you get to, that. Now have you played with that yet?
I have not played with it yet, but it does work. I mean, I've tapped the button and it gives you a disclaimer and says you're about to go live with your device. Are you
hope
sure
you're not
you
in the bathroom.
Yes. It also has some interesting features from a camera perspective that I actually want to play more with.
Mm.
It actually has a virtual shot that lets you kind of take a three-dimensional picture around something, which I thought was pretty neat.
Around the outside of something?
Yeah, remember like we were looking at some of the camera apps that would kind of let you pan around something, and as you tilted the device, it would kind of give you that three-dimensional look.
Okay, like product shots or yes, something.
Yes, it looks like it kind of does that. So maybe for that one thing that we were talking about earlier, that it could be an interesting way to capture products and devices and cool tech. The fingerprint sensor coming from the 6th generation obviously works 1,000 times better than Samsung did on their S5 model.
Mm-hmm.
The one thing I will actually say I highly, highly miss from the S6 is the infrared blaster. So on the S6, when we reviewed that, we were talking about it came with the Peel app and I could use it to remote control any home stereo, TV, anything with infrared.
Yeah.
They actually dropped it from the Note 5 and the S6 Plus.
So was that like Edge. was it like a little note, little used?
I don't know if it was little used or they just felt for the demographic they're hitting with these devices, they didn't need to hit some of the more consumer-esque type stuff. Or maybe they found that where kids were just running around from place to place, changing
well,
channels.
Well, you're going to have that. Chachi had that. The last Android phone that Chachi had, we were like turning the TV off because it was freaking annoying in the sheets, right?
Right.
I mean, this has been the thing that's been on watches for how many years? I remember kids in school like turning the TV on or off or changing the channel. I mean, this is nothing new. So I think it's just one of those like, let's stick it in or let's not. I think they're just like buffering the phone with features.
The device does have a lot of preloaded software. Interestingly enough, you can remove the majority of it. So it does come with some of your Microsoft Office apps.
Mm-hmm.
It does come with some AT&T apps because I have the AT&T model. And then it comes with all your regular stock stuff. I've added drop cam and whatnot. It works well.
I'm looking at a video here from Android Central. Does this have the curved like kind of edges to the screen?
So this doesn't have the edge.
Okay. Can I see it?
So the Note, yeah, sure. I'll actually take it out of the...
I can actually see the fanciness. Yeah.
So the S6 edge, the edge lines have the curved edge. If you kind of push up on the bottom right, it'll eject the pen. Please don't insert it backwards, which is very easy to do. So like I said, please don't insert it backwards.
So don't pull a Leo because you'll have to kind of deal with that. This comes out here.
Yeah.
Oh, and it kind of buzzes. And now I get like a screen for specific things.
So it's pretty cool too. You could probably even do it from that screen.
Hmm.
Kind of hold the stylus over the device in the air without touching. Can you see the dot? You may have to turn it back around to even see it. You can kind of
there's a dot that like it follows.
That's right. It's pretty cool. So you can see like exactly where you're tapping if you want to get real intricate or whatnot.
I'm not putting this in backwards. I'm just kind of looking at it because I've watched the everybody's watched the video, right? So supposedly, and I'm not going to do anything. Don't worry. So supposedly, you could even just drop this the wrong way in, and it won't come out all the way. And there's a sensor in there that's a little flip sensor. They kind of showed the physics of this, and it will catch it because this end where it kind of sticks out is enough to go in, but it won't come out without busting that, basically. And that's like a sensor to
tell it that it's ejected.
To tell it that it's ejected to like the little menu that popped up, like that doesn't pop up anymore, right?
Right.
Jeez, this is a beautiful phone.
The screen's amazing. The camera's phenomenal. You can actually double tap right on the home button and it brings up the camera.
Oh, that's cool.
And then if you hit it does amazing face detection.
Really?
I don't know if you noticed when you did that, it actually put a ring around your face.
Does it do it for a selfie? Yeah, it does do it on the selfie side. Okay.
You can, if you hit that mode button, it actually gives you all the different modes.
You're going to have a lot of selfies on your phone, Chilla.
And they're all uploaded to my Google Photos.
Make sure you post these later.
If you
insert this in your nose backwards, does it come back out? That's the question we're going to answer here on the Awesomecast. I guess the issue has been if it goes in backwards, they're not going to fix it. It's not covered under warranty. And the answer is read the freaking manual.
Pretty much.
And that's, I mean, kids just, unfortunate parents that let their kids play with a, you know, $600 plus phone, whatever this is. That's come on. God, this is a good looking phone.
You were talking about broadcasting, right? So you double tap to bring up the camera, right? So you still have the camera open?
Oh, I can. Mm-mm. There it is. Okay.
So now hit the mode button in I think the lower left hand corner.
There's a mode button. Okay.
Now there's broadcast.
Selfie, wide selfie, and I can a live broadcast. Is this going to go to your YouTube?
No.
No?
Because I don't have YouTube. Oh, you're not set up?
So yeah, you do get a little kind of agreement and everything. It'll set up with your account. Is it showing me behind it? No, it's showing the other side of the studio. Okay. Because I'm in, so I can agree.
And one of the cool things that Samsung did with this is they implemented.
Actually, I could go, it looks like I could go live very easily.
Oh, you might be able to.
I might be, is it okay if I do?
With my Gmail. Yeah, go ahead.
All right, I'm going to hit okay. I just accepted that. Wants me to sign in. Maybe. Maybe. We'll see what happens here. Nope, that one's a password. So that is a beautiful phone. For everything questions about, I don't recommend Samsung because I think there's too much crap on them.
But now you can remove it all. So
you can now.
Yeah, a lot of that's things awesome. You can just go on and remove. The other thing that they seem to have done is some of the things I actually probably wouldn't remove because like they now give you some free premium stuff. Like I got a 1 year to pocket. Premium.
Nice.
I got 100 gigs of space on Microsoft's cloud. So I have extra storage that I can use at any point in time. So some of those apps are pretty nice in the fact that you do get a bunch of extra type of stuff with them. And what else was I going to say to you while you were over there? I don't remember if it was about photos.
I mean, they're nice phones. They're, and I don't think until you've like kind of held one in your hand or get to a store and check out the display or something, you don't really know until you've set eyes on it. But that's nice. That is super nice.
Yeah. So far, like I said, I've been really impressed. I actually use the wireless charger, so I just literally go and lay it down next to my bed at night, and it just magically charges. Audio quality is pretty darn good. Camera quality is, I would consider, phenomenal. So all in all, if you're looking for an Android device, this would be the one I would pick up.
Wow.
At this point in time.
What if you are a beginner Androider?
I think it lends itself to the beginner Android. Oh, that's the one thing I was going to say. They implemented from the Google side that it came out in KitKat. If you get a replacement Android device, and the devices run KitKat, when you boot up the device, it'll literally say, hold this device against your other device, and it will copy everything over.
Like NFC.
NFC copy. So I actually held it against the Galaxy S6, And it's not a Samsung thing. This is a Google thing. It made its NFC connection. I had to type in my... I had to confirm my Google passwords on both devices.
Mm-hmm.
And it copied everything over.
That's amazing.
Apps, wow. Files, everything. Wow. So I thought that was a really nice way to transfer phones. Even better than some of the Apple plug this in and restore type thing. Mm-hmm. It was just
awesome.
Hold this up against your existing phone. So
that's awesome.
As a newbie, I would say yes, because their UI is pretty intuitive.
Mm-hmm.
I would say it's not as clean as the native Android Nexus experience,
mm-hmm.
but it is intuitive for your basic user.
Awesome. Go check out the Samsung Note 5. Galaxy Note 5. The stylus dilly. That's how you know, right? Cool. Katie, what do you got this week?
Oh, I could have followed you up.
You want me to go first then?
Well, I can forward. I have more stuff about Periscope.
All right, you start.
Okay, Periscope. So Periscope is heading possibly to an app to Apple TV. What this means for us is, essentially what it means for Apple TV is they're still trying to figure a way to separate themselves from the Rokus and the everything else in the world we have here. But I think it's kind of, from a marketing and a social media standpoint, now we have to build ads and experiences that can go on a giant TV.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, you know, everything is different and now you have to modify your approach. And instead of, I'm going to look great in this little teeny little square or rectangle here, and now you're on this big giant screen on Apple TV.
Right.
But I think it's going to be neat to see more of these social apps end up on Apple TV and kind of give you a whole new way to look at things. And I think it'll help people with the Periscope's numbers, because then you're going to be able to watch things, not necessarily having to look at your little phone. So people, I found out, you know, and I think you've figured out from playing with Periscope, they just like to watch you kind of live your life and experience things through you. And I think that this is a better way to do that, especially when you watch places like they might have gorgeous sunsets or sunrises or, mm-hmm. you know, any sort of landscape type places. Or if you're at a concert, now you're really there.
Exactly.
I don't have to pay for a ticket. I can just watch it through Periscope on my TV.
Like we kind of mentioned, this kind of goes hand in hand with my awesome thing, because I've been kind of, I don't know if using Periscope the way it's supposed to be used a little bit more and being more interactive about it. I kind of had a longer discussion about this on Basic Sorgonomics from this morning, so go check that out at sorgatron.com. And but again, just kind of like before I go out to the office or out to work or during the day when I'm taking a break or something, I'll just pull it up or last night during Raw during a commercial and say, hey guys, what do you think? You know, hey, what's going on? You know, or when I was on Washington the other night and sharing that kind of situation. Like you had some experiences out on the beach and showing that kind of stuff on your vacation a few weeks ago. Although that was interesting because there was the you go to bed and then we see the Periscope from you, mm-hmm. with the sun going down, and then I wake up and see the one of the sun coming up. You know, I mean, that was kind of cool, you know, to see that.
What time of day is it?
yeah, I was really confused because I slept in because I think it was post podcast day.
One of the things, and I'm not a huge person for actually creating or transmitting my video from Periscope,
mm-hmm.
but the one thing I've been getting into on Periscope is some of like the how-to people. So there's a cosplayer that's been doing some cosplay, actually creating entire costumes and whatnot for cosplay,
mm-hmm.
and she actually broadcasts her entire build cycle almost on a daily basis, which I thought was a pretty neat concept.
Wow. So here's my question with that. Is she interacting with people during this process, or are you just watching the process?
She is interacting. So some people will ask questions. They've asked like what brands of plastic does she use, or how's she coding something,
mm-hmm.
or whatnot. So she does interact. And the other one that I've actually been pretty impressed with, I think, is like shoot.edit. And it's a girl, and you might find this interesting. It's a girl in California, and she actually does a lot of her video editing broadcast.
She's a wedding videographer.
I think she does wedding and some kind of TV and whatnot.
Mm-hmm.
But so she actually does her video editing life cycle in the evenings.
Nice.
And she actually will broadcast her editing video and go through and explain what she's doing and working on. Obviously, if there's something, a couple times she said, you know, I can't show this video or I can't show that. And she'll kind of move it off screen or move it to
Yeah, you kind of have to be careful.
She has like a huge setup with like 18 screens and it's pretty intense. Those are the kind of periscopes I've been getting into. So it'll be interesting if this came to the Apple TV. Mm-hmm. I would be huge on just sitting down and going through like people doing that type of thing.
Like cooking it becomes shows. Like a
cooking show. Yeah, that'd be great.
Yeah.
Every night show yourself cooking dinner.
And it's not something, and it's that different thing. And kind of, it's happening now, or it's happening more recently. But don't we have a problem though that if we're periscoping and we're bringing it up on the TV, now we're taking up the center of our big HD wide TV?
I don't understand what the problem is with that.
Because you're going to have this single sliver of video in the middle of your big 42-inch television.
But your TV's 1080p and you can record in 1080p.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Newer Android phones are already recording 4K.
But the form factor isn't this. It's this is what I'm saying. I see what you're saying. So I don't know how does that translate? And then if you're somebody on television and you have a 16:9, a horizontal, how is that going to translate when I'm watching it on my phone? Or are we going to have two different subsets? You know, how are they going to manage this?
So here's a question. If you polled 1,000 eighth graders and said, do you care if your video on your TV is portrait with black bars on the left and right?
Mm-hmm.
How many of them do you think care?
Okay.
I mean, I care and you care.
Right.
As video people and people that care about quality.
Yeah.
But they're also the first ones that'll watch 8-bit Minecraft.
Oh my gosh.
Really bad video quality,
mm-hmm.
and someone just playing Minecraft. So I'm not saying that we should condone the concept.
You're saying it's not going to matter.
I'm saying we should just get over it. People,
we're the old fogies here.
Yes,
and we should just get over it.
The whippersnappers of today.
Your Apple TV is just going to be, the vertical, and it's whatever it's going to be.
But it's just like I griped. Think about back in the 80s and 90s. I griped all the time about you have to buy the letterbox edition. You're missing stuff in Star Wars. You're missing the things on the left and right. And people then said, I hate Letterbox because you get black bars on top and bottom. Because
we all had 4-3 TVs. Because
we all had 4-3 TVs.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So now it's kind of the inverse. Or maybe Periscope will start to support the landscape and you'll be good to go.
Oh, jeez. Mm-hmm. Oh, geez.
I mean, just imagine the social interaction. I mean, I could be home by myself and all my, maybe I live by myself and I'm like, oh, I want to hang out with somebody and make dinner or watch a movie or watch a show. And now I'm watching the show with them and they're conversing with me through voice and me through text.
It would be great if the Periscope was actually just something you threw in the corner as you were watching something. So if it was like we're watching Monday Night Raw.
Well, wait a minute, though, because the iPad Air 2 has that capability.
It does.
So on my Air 2, I can take a YouTube video or any video together. And I can put it in a picture-in-picture.
And this is why we need to upgrade the Apple TVs in this announcement that you guys have probably heard by the time you hear this, depending on when you hear this show. We're pontificating at this point. So, but supposedly, hopefully, the Apple TV is going to have apps and we're finally going to get the Jesus box under our TV that will do all this stuff and just connect everything together. So, and I can throw away all my dongles.
No more dongles. Dongle
no
free.
More dongles. Yeah. Dongle-free TV.
Woo.
Back to the boxes. Put the dongles away. Wow. All right. Well, we have some stuff, some recommended stuff going on here. And another app of the week Chilla has for his super exclusive Samsung stuff. But in the meantime, I want to direct you guys over to Slice on Broadway at sliceonbroadway.com. They're here. If you are in Pittsburgh, and I know a lot of you guys are in the Pittsburgh area, go check them out. They're in the South Hills of Pittsburgh, down along the tracks in Beachview. If you're taking the train, you probably pass it on the red line. And also in Carnegie, PA, down on Main Street, fresh ingredients, great stuff, great taste in pizza, some of the best stuff, approved by a guy that lived in the Bronx. And that takes a lot. That's saying something there. So please check them out, sliceonbroadway.com, PGH_slice on the Twitters. Let them know you heard about them on the Awesomecast. Like I said, we're going to be meeting and having some Slice on Broadway with our Patreon supporter here in a couple of weeks. So I'm excited for that. Get to experience that with one of our listeners. Go ahead down there. Say hi to Rico. That's the guy on the front page right there, pictured. So please go check that out. Slice on Broadway. Thanks to them for supporting the show for well over a year of Pittsburgh podcasting. So, all right, Chilla, what is this fancy spancy side sync app that you got here?
We talk, I talk a lot about, you know, screencasting and the ways that you can show off your mobile device screen. We've talked about Reflector in the past. We've talked about Reflectors and Air Squirrels. We've talked about using the player right inside of Mac OS. This is one that's from Samsung, and it works with Samsung devices, and it's called SideSync. It'll actually let you mirror your device to your laptop. Obviously, SideSync is preloaded on any Samsung Galaxy device as well as any other laptops. They do have Windows and Mac installs for SideSync. It's an application that runs on your laptop or desktop. You can, and the big thing for me is that you can connect over both Wi-Fi and by tethering to the device. So if you don't want to use up precious Wi-Fi, or the company you work for doesn't allow you to connect device to device over Wi-Fi, you can actually connect tethered via USB cable, which is really nice. So not only can you screen mirror, and I haven't fully played with the application yet, so I'm not going to lie. Not only can you screen mirror, but I hear that you can actually remote control the device, as well as text. So if you're familiar with iOS and how it works with Yosemite, and what was the one before Yosemite? El Capitan and Yosemite. So I can take my phone calls.
I keep forgetting it's called El Capitan. I'm going to play who does the song? Son of a Jesus has, or Heaven is a half pipe. Those guys. OPM. I'm going to play the OPM song like when it comes out, like nonstop.
So you can actually text and take and make phone calls right from within the app, which I thought was a pretty nice way to kind of to parallel with the device, as well as a lot of drag and drop capabilities and features. I can drag and drop pictures right from my camera roll on the device. Now that I have plenty of pictures of Sorg, I can drag those right to my PowerPoint presentation I'm working on my laptop. You can also drag back documents that you're working on and such back to the device. So pretty nice app. Like I said, unfortunately, it is Samsung devices only. And it's called Samsung SideSync. They're on version 4.0, but it definitely lends a hand to allowing you to do a whole slew of things past what their keys. They have a keys product that's kind of like an iTunes, but this kind of takes it to the next level.
Awesome. So we got one from the chat room. I didn't know about this. Have you guys heard of Facebook Mentions? I know, it sounds like you should have, right?
I have not. Did someone mention it on Facebook?
Somebody mentioned it in the chat room. Ooh. And I'm trying to, my page isn't verified, so what am I doing this as? Okay, so I've downloaded this thing. It's mostly a video app. It's in the center of the screen here. Sorry, it's a little busy over there. So I guess I need to sign in as a page. So I have to be an entity. So let's go ahead and just sign in as Awesomecast. I think this will work. Is that what's going on? My page isn't verified. Oh, this is interesting. My page isn't verified, so now I have to go in this process. This is new. I just downloaded this on his recommendation. And I need to put in my new password. Okay. But it looks like it's video streaming. This is the thing. The Facebook Live I've been hearing about for a while. And actually, if you go to the page for Facebook Mentions, you see The Rock has obviously been using this. And it is like the he's telling me in the chat that it's like a Periscope kind of thing. So there you go. So this is their answer. This is Facebook's response to all this video that we've been doing. Government issued photo ID. Holy crap. So I got to go through a lot of stuff. So let me look at the stuff it's making me do. I have to get verified for mentions to the point where, hold on a second. Like to the point where it says select my page. And let's see if I go in here, let's say I'll do, let's find Awesomecast. So we got Awesomecast, and it says government-issued photo ID. So I actually need to take a picture of my driver's license, an official website. If Apple, please provide a link to your website, send it. Well, wow, they're pretty serious about this. So this isn't as easily and low maintenance as you just pop on. But this is the thing they've had again. Celebrities start. So this is, they want this to be brands first. You have to have a Facebook page first before you get involved with this. That's really interesting. It's like they're doing from the top down instead of like Periscope and Meerkat or from the bottom up. Yeah. I mean, it is, again, like Ricky Gervais has had this, some other, I don't know, like Lady Gaga or something. I think some WWE people, some of the wrestlers have had this over the last few weeks. So they've been kind of working it out from there. And I guess just testing it with those people and getting attention for it there.
So is it a lot? It's a live broadcast, but does it let you kind of save it off? I wonder how that works.
I don't know. We're not in that far. We're not verified enough. I have to go scan my, take a picture of my driver's license in order to do anything with this thing, apparently. But looking at the website, it looks like, let's see, you can go live, share everywhere, talk with fans. So again, it's kind of, you know, they're showing Miley Cyrus, for instance, in this case. So, I mean, you can kind of see what they're aiming at. Stay in the loop. So they're talking about like Facebook, Super Bowl, things like that. It's only on the Apple App Store for now. So that's why Wheels isn't giving me a lot of information on this other than it exists. I don't know. It's their plague. You know, I mean, we have YouTube, has YouTube Live built into Samsung phones. Obviously, that's going to be more. I think they've really kind of retrofitted and put up front that their live capabilities with that new gaming redesign that we talked about last week. And now this is the way that Facebook's getting into it. I remember Facebook's the one that did like Skype calling and mm-hmm. like built in Skype, one-to-one Skype calling in Facebook for the longest time, and it never seemed to catch up. I went to try to do it a couple months ago because I'm like, oh, let's do the Facebook thing. And it's browser to browser. It doesn't work anywhere else, and it never caught on. So I don't know what – maybe they're hoping celebrities will be on this, and this will boost that up. I don't think this is just for everybody to broadcast, though.
I feel like this would have been a better fit inside of Instagram.
Right, right. Actually, there was a weird mention when I looked at it. Let's see – because when I looked up the mentions thing, like part of the copy was about staying connected on Instagram as well. Yeah, share updates across. It says share updates across Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter, all from one app. When they're all talking about this, it's in the Google description, but I didn't find it when I was looking through the page. So it's an interesting play. I'm obviously going to be playing with this after I scan my driver's license. I don't want to do that here on the air. After the local news just scared me about handing over my driver's license to that teller. So there's that. But no, thanks to Wheels, we'll be checking that out and hopefully have a little more to tell you about in the near future. So from there, we also have, we talked about your app. Let's Alex Cars. He had an awesome thing of the week last week. I kind of skipped it. Sorry about that, Alex. But he said here's Carrier. He has Boost Mobile out there in around Long Beach in California, and he says his Carrier is offering an extra 2 gigabytes of data per month free to customers who have been on the same plan for 3 months or more prior. The only catch is any change of plan forfeits the free extra data. And you're just telling me about how you got kicked up 5 gigabytes over on AT&T as well for free out of nowhere, right? So, and I'm still on the 30 gig upgrade from 15, and I've just been not caring about data for the longest time. I'm at like 22 gigabytes with a day left. I'm just like, you know what, whatever. And I get rollover for the next month. So I usually have like an extra 7 to 10 gigabytes just to go crazy on. But he says, no, Boost offers unlimited call, text, and data. The price of your service depends on how much of that data you want to be high speed, 3G or 4G. He's currently paying $45 for 5 gigs of high speed data. So this bumps me up to 7, which is pretty nice. So that's interesting. So it's kind of like how T-Mobile is always like, oh, unlimited data, but we're going to slow you down under 5 gigabytes. Regardless, mm-hmm. you get to choose where that barrier is with Boost.
Well, I think you can do that with T-Mobile now.
You can now?
T-Mobile will let you go to a larger cap above the 5. I think 5 is kind of their base. I think this is nice. What I'm interested in is how slow does it get once you hit the cap? Is it unbearably slow? Is it 56K modem slow?
Have you been on Edge? It's usually Edge.
So I use, and that's, I guess my point is, when you hit Edge on an iPhone,
mm-hmm. most modern apps,
stops. Won't even work.
It halts.
Yeah. So while it's nice that they're letting you continue to consume data, to me it's not really consumable data. Mm-hmm. It's like me saying, here, you can come to this all-you-can-eat buffet, and after you have 2 tacos, I will feed you mud. All the mud you can eat. But it's you know what I mean? Like, it's kind of a sales scheme. So I do like the fact that they're bumping up, and they obviously companies are finding a need to bump everyone up,
mm-hmm.
and obviously they're finding there's that data need, doesn't cost
a,
as much.
There's
as
a desire for it, right. And people are willing to pay for it. So I think,
but all these people are paying aren't paying for it. That's my point.
But also notice there's the catch in there. You can't change your plan. So now it locks you in. It's another reason to lock you in. I was going to bump down to 10 gigabytes or whatever the next lower plan was from the 30. I'm like, I don't need 30. I could get away with 15 or 20 again. But there's no – I'm still jumping from the 15 to 10 price. So mm-hmm. there's no reason for what I'm going to save for what I'm going to lose in data. And then I'll never get that 30 gigabytes at that price again. Now I'm locked into that
mm-hmm.
financially or you know, in my head or something like that. It's all just these little tricks to get you hooked into their service even more so.
So what's he going to do with his extra 2 gigs?
Apparently, since he just noticed that Periscope is on Android, he's going to be testing that out a bit. And so he's going to use that real quick. So, and I don't know. I don't know how much of that is attributed to I just pull up a Periscope or I'm screaming like whenever the heck I want to, you know.
Or are they seeing that their voice line and a lot of their other data sections aren't being utilized? So they now have more.
I'll tell you what, our call times and everything have plummeted. Plummeted. Katie, do we even talk on the phone for things we need to do? Like it's all texting, right?
I was like, I don't think I've ever talked to you on the phone.
We've never picked up a phone, right? Yep. My wife calls me, and sometimes I have to take a business call, and those are scheduled. I'm never mm-hmm. picking up the phone. Period. So. And I think they're seeing that, and they just need something to hook you in.
Or are we gonna see the concept of voice go away, and it's all gonna be voice over IP, which your voice is then gonna consume your data?
Well, I wonder. Mm. They can't get rid of it because there's still plenty of people worthwhile that are on pre-smartphones.
Mm-hmm.
You know that need that data. You know, I think they would only get rid of it if there weren't making enough money off of it. So I think there's enough people on older phones that aren't going to upgrade to these things, you know.
There's people that don't have smartphones.
Oh yeah, I was setting one up and I couldn't figure out the voicemail. Tried.
*611.
Nope.
You hold down one of the keys
on Verizon.
I honestly don't know.
No, I know how to get into the voicemail, but I couldn't figure out how to change the greeting.
Oh.
And the menus for voicemail are different depending on what region you're in, because whoever they bought it from, and they haven't changed it. And, like, to the point where if you're in Western PA versus the Philadelphia area, it's different.
Wow.
And I was I actually was getting help from Twitter, from Verizon support, and they said try this, and I went to those things, and it still didn't match what they said it was supposed to be. Like, there was the whole menu tree, and didn't match anything. So I was like, dude, just take it to the Verizon store and
mm-hmm.
let them do it.
Help me.
Yeah, seriously. We had some comments about the Facebook video, the Facebook mentions earlier. Juggalo John was saying, yeah, but Facebook is real shady with their video, from fudging their view numbers. They count every auto start as a view, for instance. No content ID, and keep people from freebooting other people's content. Yeah, I mean, I think it just didn't have a lot of stuff in place that we expect something like YouTube to have. I just had to do a content ID. Well, my wife actually had to do a content ID, and I think she had to email all the materials, but there was the recommendation when I read it was to snail mail your cease and desist to the company for the DMCA takedown notice. Digital Millennium Copyright Act is what it starts with, the word digital, and you wanted me to snail mail it. You know, there's a problem there. So again, that's for VO or something like that. One of the kind of sketchier of the video hosting sites had one of our DVDs on there that we put out. And I think it's okay that Facebook didn't have this stuff in place yet. Because why put all that infrastructure in if the thing doesn't take off? So I think as they go, I mean, they can eat the cost of any issues that this reaches. And I look at the stats. Okay, the numbers are weird. And there's also separate numbers. There's people that have watched, and then there's people that have watched over 30 seconds. I like that distinction, because that audience, you don't get that distinction on YouTube. If somebody goes and watches 2 seconds of your video, like half of our Awesomecast stats can be somebody that watched for 2 seconds and said, this isn't for me. But a lot of them found it. Therefore, our stats skyrocketed. Now I can go in and get audience retention. But if you're looking at that number when you're looking at somebody's video, you don't know if people were digging it or not. You know,
well, it's an interesting thing we run into at work, because we actually track attentiveness. Mm-hmm. And one of the problems I have with tracking that is if you click outside of the presentation window, it loses attention.
Right.
But I very well could be watching a video and someone instant messages me and says, "Do you want to go to lunch?" And I say yes. If I don't click, and then I continue watching the video, right?
Right.
If I don't click back on the window that the video was in, I don't get counted for being attentive.
Mm-hmm.
So that attention stat can also skew in the opposite direction depending on what's going on. And that's one of those metrics that bother me because I don't necessarily know how the back end's treating it.
Right.
They could say they only watched 3 seconds and for me,
somebody who's trying to figure out, okay, we have how many people watching X, so we can like maybe go to an advertiser and say we have this, but there's always going to be the asterisk by it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and then how are we going to look going to, well, these are the numbers that are reported, but as we know, these could or could not be real people that are actually looking at our video.
Yeah.
So let's put a marginal error of X, you know, and we're trying to figure out what that math is and how to present that to companies, being a lower end podcast compared to a Twit, of course, or something like that. But
you just might as well just say everybody in the world has the ability to watch our video.
That's good. The potential reach is astounding. I mean, I was looking at the stats for which one was it? One of my clients, and most of their video views are in France.
Whoa.
The name of the company is French.
French.
French name, Pakistani owned. That's where we went. So, and actually, if you look at Middle Eastern companies, there's also a big spike there, I think, because of the names of some of the doctors, too, because they're they look like they're very common names in those locations. So I think they're coming through on that as well. So, John also mentions, it could still fall flat. We're talking about celebrities being involved in this thing first. Mm-hmm. He has Vessel and never watched more than 2 things on it. And that was we're taking all the YouTube stars, we're going to put them over here, and we're trying to get them to do agreements to put stuff out first here for the paying people.
Mm-hmm.
So, and yeah, that seemed like a weird thing. I didn't think I was going to pay for it, but there's plenty of audiences that this is what they watch. So I don't know. So. Okay, we'll get to some more stories and actually some more submitted content as well from a lot of guys. Everybody's giving us some really great stories on Twitter, emails, everything. I can't wait to get the Cat Street View.
Yes.
Before we're done with this thing. Maybe we'll do that here after the quick break. But also, we're doing a lot of videos. I can't wait to tell you some of the stuff that I'm working on coming up. Some stuff with some companies that we're definitely going to share. I've told them, it's like part of me working with you is I'm going to talk about them on my podcast because you're working on really cool stuff. Okay. I don't know if that's a business pitch of any sort, actually, but that's what we're doing here at Sorgatron Media. We have Sorgatron Media Services, soon to be renamed, very soon. There might be a .com purchase that happened over the weekend. I'm very excited about that. But in the meantime, if you're looking for video services, if you're looking for help for social media, if you just want to do this darn podcasting thing and figure out what a microphone is, we can help you with that too. Please check us out, sorgatronmedia.com. You can see a lot of samples of what we're doing. You can contact us, and we can help you kind of figure out how to tell your story on the internets. So please check out that, all the shows, all the content, all the things we can help you with at sorgatronmedia.com. And I do a lot of the discussion over basic Sorgonomics and the newsletter as well that you can sign up for at sorgatron.com and sorgatronmedia.com. Like the Periscope. I go deep into the Periscope and a lot of discussion about... Oh, excuse me. That's okay. That's okay. A lot of discussion about what are we doing with Periscope and what could it do for a business, for instance. Hey, a little bit of that playing for you guys here in the chat room as we were getting started for the Awesomecast tonight, for instance. So go check that out, sorgatronmedia.com. Maybe we can help you.
Watching these ladies on here, and I'm sorry, ladies, I don't know who you are, but it's interesting to see what they're doing to try to improve their appearances.
Mm-hmm.
It's just very interesting. To make real life filters is fun to watch.
We were at Hardcore Homecoming, and I'm sitting next to Sabu, and he's eating tuna, and I'm like, he's like, "You got a fork?" And I look in the bag, and there's one of New Jack's forks in the bag, and it's got blood from the night before. And I'm like, "Yeah, but it's got blood on it." And before I could even say, "Yeah, dude, but it's got blood on it," Sabu starts eating the tuna with his fork, and I'm like, "Are you kidding me?" That's how out of your mind this business has put you.
Like, all the scenes are hand painted.
Wow.
I don't know how, but all the scenes are hand-painted. That's what they were touting. And
technology, Chris.
It really pops. It really looks like an actual scene from a storybook.
But if you have an idea of what we can do on our end, in a call with Sonny.
Absolutely not.
In a call with Sonny. No, no, I just want to hear the ideas. And this trumps any conversation we've had. Because it seems that our guest has a promo video for Bar Jutsu with Sonny in it. So let's get the cats. If I can find out where I put it. So this was sent from our friend Chris. Mm-hmm. Chick Chris on the Twitters. Oh, where'd it go? I lost it. Oh, it's up here. I found it. I had it in the wrong section. I'm sorry about that. So this was over on Vox.com. Japan just created a Google Street View for cats. Katie, I know you were a big fan of this. Can you tell me about what's going on here?
This is awesome. It's nice because also Google translates things for you.
Mm-hmm.
Certain things in the website, so you can actually kind of see once you get in there what you're actually the translation. But it stores and things from the cat's eyes point of view. So you get to see excuse me. That places are much larger when you're tiny. And things that cats should check out when they're walking. And I'm dying, I'm sorry.
You have a hairball?
Yes.
It's the cats.
It's okay.
Your cat, you can see, you can actually follow different cats.
Mm-hmm. Wait, so it was like, are the cats tagged? Like, what? So they street viewed it, and it's the cats, mm-hmm. and you're just like seeing everything from the cat's point of view here, and I'm just mm-hmm. looking through the kind of pictures that they have going on here, and there's cats in the street view pictures, which I enjoy that as well.
Yes.
Which makes me want to see the street view cat. By the way, side note, there's a street view car that lives like a block away from me over here. That's like I think he just drives it home, and he parks it like a block away. And we saw when we were having coffee at the top of the hill the other mm-hmm. week last week, didn't we? But no, this looks really cool. So let's see if the site loaded here.
Yeah.
So I'm going to hit start. Oh, I missed my chance to translate. So this is going to be a lot of fun. Mm-hmm. Let's see if it gives me another. It's loading. This is the slower of the computers here, so it might take a moment. But
it took a little bit. Even I mean, not saying that mine's very high speed.
Mm-hmm. Hello.
But it took a second with mine to load up, too.
But no, really interesting. So why did they do this? Do we know? Other than it's cats and it's Japan and we love cats. That's enough for us?
Yeah, that's plenty for me.
It doesn't seem to be loading on this computer. I might have an old Chrome on here, so might have a problem. So you can check this out. So Cat Street View. Oh, it's loading.
Woo.
It's loading. Let's see what we got here.
Cats.
So I look to be in some kind of mall sort of situation. Uh-huh.
You're this cat on the left there.
I'm the cat on the left, Mr. Prairie Pants, because I can't read what that says. And it's still loading a little bit. Might load for a bit here. But you see, I got a little bit of a map here, so I'm guessing I can probably jump around a little bit.
Yeah, you're in a major shopping center there.
I'm in a major shopping center. I'm seeing it change a little bit. It's starting to load a little bit. There's a little guy there. I got a little paw print here to look around.
Mm-hmm.
So, okay. Cat's eye view. I dig it. It's kind of loading as we go. That's cool. That's nice. Google's going to buy them in like 3 weeks. You watch. Look, there's a little ride over here. It's a little panda ride. That looks awkward. That's cool.
So it combines both our love for places we've never visited and cats.
That's right. That's mm-hmm. right. Cats review, you can go to Hiroshima-welcome.com/canpai/Cat Street View. Probably just look for Cat Street View. You're going to find this mm-hmm. thing. So there you go.
Thanks, Chris.
Thank you, Chris, for sharing that for the awesome cast. Let's see. We also have. And we do have a. What is this? We got a response on the Twitters? Yes, that's from nobody in here. Cindy Klosky responded to a question, apparently, that we had on our audience poll. Do you actually use your phone to talk to people, using it as a phone versus messaging? Regular on the show, Cindy Klosky actually responded to that. She estimates that she uses her phone 8% to message, 12% to receive and make calls, and 80% to use the web, email, social media, list, and watch. So there you go. There's some anecdotal. But she's a technology person, too. So,
yeah, but she's also a
business type person.
Yeah, in technology, though. So I mean, she's definitely going to be more towards that skew of things. Mm-hmm. So, but thank you for putting that out there. And let's know if there's any more responses to that. Okay, what else do we have here? Okay, Chilla, is there any of these stories that kind of strike in your fancy you want to get to today?
So, on the eve of mm-hmm. Apple announcements, let's just steer away from Apple in general.
Yeah, I mean, just the time that people listen to this is probably not going to be ridiculous. Yeah. There's going to be a phone. Some of us here may buy it. Probably.
There's going to be new OSs. There's going to be an iPad.
Yeah, there's going to be an iPad. There's going to be an Apple TV that I'm going to Periscope with, and I don't know.
The one thing that caught my attention, and I don't think we've talked about it here, but I've been actually talking about it a lot at work, is Microsoft's Continuum mm-hmm. device. And it's towards the end of the show notes. I think it's one up from the bottom.
Ideal phone experience?
Yes. You'll notice the picture is the cat ninja, the unicorn, the dinosaur, and I can't see what the
narwhal. Narwhal. Something you need.
What is that? It's a narwhal.
Oh my gosh. Like an octopus? No, it's a narwhal. It's like a unicorn whale.
Okay.
We'll have to watch a video later, Chilla.
So
don't feel bad. I don't know the narwhal either.
Oh my gosh, what's wrong with you both?
I don't know it.
So this little box is something that you can actually dock your phone in.
Okay, so this is the I want my phone to be my computer
everywhere I go.
Brain.
Yes. So the Continuum Dock allows you to take your phone and dock it and use a full-size mouse, keyboard,
mm-hmm.
And display. Where I think companies kind of failed in the past, especially on the Android side, was they just tried to make the apps bigger. With Windows and now the concept of write the app once and it works anywhere, you're obviously designing the app to run on all the different size UIs. So that's where I think that Microsoft has actually potentially cracked the nut, so to say, where I'll be able to take my phone, dock it, and then I get the full-blown Windows experience with full-blown Word versus the Word mobile experience when it's not in the dock.
Hmm.
I think this could quickly become key, and as phones continue to expand their capabilities and technology, I could definitely see this taking off. We've talked about, you know, obviously... running high-intensive processor-type applications will obviously kill your battery while you're in a dock and charging, so that shouldn't be an issue, versus maybe I'm just showing a PowerPoint and mirroring my display, but not in the dock. So I could definitely see this taking hold, and with the app library that Microsoft doesn't have today, I could see them quickly... consuming all those types of applications, which part of me wonders if this also isn't why Instagram is reluctant to create a Windows app, because they don't want desktop applications for Instagram.
Mm-hmm.
And this would kind of automatically lend itself to that.
Cause they can't define what is this.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Right. Like kind of like how, when you want to watch videos and they don't let you watch it on TV, because they're like, no, we just want mobile. We want you to buy cable in order to watch it on your TV.
Right.
And if there's like that crossover, they just won't let it happen. That's interesting.
And a lot of people are saying, no, this will never catch on. It didn't work for Android. And that was back in Android 2.2 and 2.3.
Of course it didn't work in Android back then. Holy crap.
So that's where this technology to me is extremely interesting, as well as they're saying their hub has an unconfirmed price of $100, which is...
That's not bad.
Which isn't bad.
That's not bad at all.
No, I'm sure that doesn't include your keyboard and your mouse and the actual monitor to hook up to it.
Right, right.
But $100 dock is
nothing. It's kind of like the Mac Mini kind of concept where, well, you probably have that stuff,
mm-hmm.
right? So you can grab the last monitor and just hook this up and upgrade later. You know, right. I mean, I think that almost solves a workstation problem for businesses if that's all you need. and you're buying one device instead of, okay, you got your phone, you got your desktop computer, you know, or iPad, or laptop, or whatever the case may be, and it's just like, you have this.
And think about it, too. You typical people, every 2 to 3 years, I would say, get a new phone.
Right.
Now you have a new PC. You've solved the problem of people never upgrading their PC, because they're always going to be upgrading their phone, which then in turn is their PC for upgrade.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I could, if this works as it's stated, I would definitely look at recommending the Windows based phones.
Mm-hmm. It has a better chance of working now more than ever.
Right.
If anything. So speaking of TV and stuff, did you guys see the news from Hulu this week? That they are going to have a non-commercial version of their service for $4 more a month. Our buddy Doug said that's brought him back to Hulu.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Brought him back.
That brought him back to Hulu. So, you're a cord cutter. First, are you on Hulu, Chilla?
Me, I'm not.
You're not.
So Hulu, the only thing that Hulu would have gotten me was the over-the-air channels, which I have the TiVo, so I can record all the over-the-air channels,
mm-hmm.
and I can fast-forward.
You're doing this on your own.
So I'm kind of doing it on my own at a cheaper cost. Am I getting some of the content that Hulu has? No, I'm not getting the USA. I'm not getting...
And plus Hulu, when the Epix deal goes away on Netflix, or maybe it already has it, end of this month or end of last, Hulu is actually going to get that deal. So the movies that are going away from Netflix will be on Hulu and actually also on Prime. I have both, so I'm good. I'm good. I'm not going to miss anything. So, Katie, you're a cord cutter of sorts.
Sorts.
I don't know. Are you a cord? Never? I don't know.
I don't know. I use my Xfinity Go and I use my Netflix. So
that's right.
And WWE Network.
But does this kind of get your attention having the no commercial option here?
No.
No, not really. Sorry. That sounds like you're getting most of your stuff through other means. So
yeah, no, I don't know. Like I wish I could say yeah, I'm really totally into it, but I don't watch enough TV to get into it. And I mean, like, if I was more into shows, I tend to rewatch the same thing over and over again because it's a background sound for me.
Right, right, right.
Versus, like, an actual thing that I watch. That's kind
of what it is for us most of the time.
But I think if I was more into shows, I think, like, this would be a great option for my mom,
mm-hmm.
who's really good with Netflix now, and I could get her into Hulu. And because a lot of the shows she watches are on, the ABCs, the CBSs, you know, the basic, those channels.
And see
go ahead.
The big thing for me, we were talking about quality earlier, right? Quality of a broadcast, quality of video. To me, there is nothing that beats the over-the-air, uncompressed video
quality. I'm with you on that. I'm with you on that, but it just doesn't fit my schedules.
And that's why I have the TiVo for a DVR.
Mm-hmm.
That's where, I think I pulled out that one device that was the Elgato tuner that you could plug in USB to any machine, and they had a recording.
Right.
That works the same way. When I only had a two-channel DVR for over-the-air, I was actually using that to record Arrow and a couple CW shows when I only had the ability to get two channels at once. So now I have the four-channel DVR, so I can actually record six channels simultaneously between the two DVRs. But to me, that's the difference, right? I would rather... I'm paying less for higher quality content.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
To me, I don't know what Hulu would get me. Now, if you want to draw me in Hulu, if you want me to start paying, get some kind of Marvel Comics universe show that you only have...
Mm-hmm.
And then I would subscribe to you. And
what, the Seinfeld and the South Park isn't doing it for you? All the seasons of Elementary are now on here. We got some Mythbusters on here as well. Actually, that's kind of got me a little bit. Movie trailers, there's that. No commercials. Now, and even the no commercials, some shows are not opted in to the no commercials.
Yeah.
And even you may, in most cases, you do get pre-roll commercials.
And okay, I mean, pre-roll commercials aren't the end of it, end of the world, because you wouldn't get.
But this is the same service that also has anything on USA. I can't watch on a device or TV even if I have Hulu Plus, and in some cases I can't even watch it in my browser unless I log in with a cable subscription. So there's always going to be this, well, you get all this stuff, but just because it's on our site doesn't mean you're going to get it as part of the plan. Mm-hmm. Like, there's always been that weirdness going on with it. So, I mean, if I sign up for this, because I got, I put Hulu to bed for a couple months after the Daily Show went off air, and I'm just going to let it go until, you know, all the shows come back, like at the beginning of October or whatever it is, because it's just, it's convenient for us. It's our DVR, right? And that's how we're used to do it. We're not going to manage a TiVo. We're not going to manage something like that. It's just, okay, we come home, click on, oh, what's on? I think Eric was on last night, so we'll watch that tonight, you know?
And see, I'm sorry, this is where I think user-generated content is going to end up taking over, and the cable companies are going to wish they had done something sooner, and it's going to be too late, because the youth of today would rather watch you play a video game.
That's right.
Live.
Mm-hmm.
Than worry about a commercial for a TV show. A TV show that aired last week with commercials, and having to figure out, okay, if I want to watch it, I have to watch it on this PC, and I have to type in this user ID and password, but this one I can watch on this device. They don't care anymore. Mm-hmm. And it's sad to a point. But they just want content to consume, and the easiest way to consume it. And all these complexities are what are driving people away from the cable companies. Mm-hmm. And I think HBO and Showtime have figured that out. They said, okay, you're right. We're going to do the HBO Nows and the I don't know what Showtime is. Showtime Anytime?
I think so. Something like that.
Anywhere.
Cinemax Go.
Yeah.
And Now and whatever.
And they're all going to come up with their own a la carte.
CBS Everywhere.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I'm with you. I think it's just going to be you pick and choose. And most of the stuff you want to watch, there's a way to do it.
Mm-hmm.
So, and the people are smart enough to do it. I mean, certainly. Yeah, for now.
I mean, that's why I think it'll be interesting as Xbox gets its TV tuner built in. So you're going to get over the air with Xbox One.
Mm-hmm. So this is a good point. John is saying, well, actually, they do have Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. and Agent Carter from ABC.
But I can DVR
But you can
that.
Get them other places. But yeah. But for me, that doesn't have that option to DVR
things.
That
makes sense for you.
That makes sense for me. It's worth it for me to pay for that $8, $12 a month. Because during that season, when everything's up, when I got Gotham, Arrow, Flash, I guess all the superhero ones, right? Supergirl, I'm going to have to figure out, because CBS usually doesn't play nice with Hulu. So, you know, it's worth it, because I can just say, okay, what's next? We discovered iZombie because it was on Hulu, and enjoyed the heck out of it, by the way. So, and Netflix is really a lot of catch up, and that kind of fills in the gap on the off season as well. So, and their originals are nice. I like Quick Draw. I like Awesome, The Awesomes. But they're definitely not as high quality as you see on Netflix. Certainly not as high quality as you see on Netflix. So,
okay. Which is surprising because of the backing they have.
I know, right? It's one of those big corporate things where, okay, you have the backing of the corporations, but you don't have the emotional, if that makes sense, backing the main partners.
So how much is, Hulu per month with the extra $4 tacked on?
$11.99.
Okay.
Which isn't terrible.
That's not bad at all.
It's a lot of stuff.
Mm-hmm. It's a lot of stuff. Because I was thinking,
plus you're gonna watch the new Hunger Games on it. Hunger Games on it. Or yeah, whatever the new movies. Ninja Turtles will be over there, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I mean it's got some significant movies coming to it, so it's gonna compete with a Netflix and a Amazon Prime at that point. So it'll be interesting to watch what's going on there.
It was neat for a while because it was like you could have multiple services and it was okay because nothing overlapped, and now everything's trying to slightly overlap and now you're like, oh, wait a minute, I can't afford
it. Right. I honestly would not be paying for Amazon Prime if it didn't just kind of was there, you know? And even like it is nice because, you know, there's some stuff that's missing because sometimes you could watch everything. Justice League and all the other shows, if you're into that line of stuff, all the DC animation stuff over on Netflix. But for whatever reason, Batman and Superman, the animated series, are just on Prime. Mm-hmm. So, you know, those little gaps like that, where you're like, well, where's this program at? And you kind of follow the breadcrumbs there. Mm-hmm. So it's interesting. For instance, I really wanted to watch Desperado, and I found out it's on Crackle.
Yeah.
Which means a 2-hour movie is going to take us 3 with all the commercial breaks.
Mm-hmm.
So that's just horrible. Mm-hmm. Horrible. It's like if I wanted that, I'd just get cable and watch FX, you know? So, what else do we have here? Let's see. We talked about Hulu. Speaking of Street View and apps, so there's a Street View app now. That's, and I was actually talking with somebody about an app that they could go take spherical kind of check-ins, the places during weather and everything. And now it's built right into an app, right in Street View itself. So, and I think this is probably Android only to begin with. From the sounds of it, they're showing it off at IFA, and I'm not sure. I'm gonna check that out to see if it's out yet. And I think I lost my Android tablet, so somewhere in the house. I hope
you lost it.
It kind of disappeared after PodCamp, so it was in my bag. It's probably in the office. I don't know. It's like a black slab that disappears on any desk that I sit down at. So. That's cool that they kind of separate it out and you can create your own a little bit easier and create. And we've seen these apps before where you could create these kind of picturesque things, and it's cool to just have it part of the Google ecosystem. So look for the Street View app, Wheels. I know you'll be looking for it. So check that out. Rick and Morty's on Hulu. That's a show that people tell me I should be watching.
Yes.
Is it?
No, I hear that a lot.
You hear that a lot too?
Yes.
Like just like Adventure Time, which I think is also on Hulu. So I might have to do some catching up, and it might be worthwhile. I don't know. Just like sitting down and watching The League and Wilfred, I've been catching up on lately. You know, just in nice 22-minute bites without commercials makes the difference to me. You know, and just go back to that. Okay, on that point, what is going on? I think there's an announcement tomorrow.
I understand. There is too.
I think there's something going on tomorrow, Chilla.
I think Apple at 1 p.m. Eastern time is going to broadcast information.
Information
to the world.
We have information
at 10 a.m. Pacific, 1 p.m. Eastern.
We control your airwaves. Sometimes it might be in a different language, but we control your airwaves.
And I find it interesting too, because this is the first time they're going to live broadcast on non-Apple devices.
So they said so you don't need a Safari browser, for instance, right? You don't need to be on an iPhone. Or maybe
you can be. You can just be on other devices as well now.
Right. So that's been, and considering how much trouble they've had keeping the stream up when they had that limitation, I'll be curious to see what happens tomorrow as well. So, yeah. Again, expectations. There have been leak happy, so there haven't been a lot of surprises a lot of times with these. But we are expecting an upgraded Apple TV, like we talked about with the app rumors earlier with Periscope. iPhone updates. I think you're just going to see an incremental C update from the sixes and six pluses.
I'll be interested to S model. Because I don't think there's going
to
be.
S. Yeah, that's what I meant to say.
I'll be interested to see how they handle that. There was some company that actually rented out the side of a truck and drove it around some city, begging them not to go with the S moniker.
Why?
Some marketing company. They didn't like the. I don't know. I thought it was kind of humorous.
Okay.
To your point, yes. Phone. I don't know what we're gonna. I think you're gonna see tablets glossed over. I think you're gonna see a new tablet.
So you think the tablets are going to be much like the tablets become to the point where like, oh, and by the way, we updated the Air. Right. Oh, and by the way, we did a spec.
But I think you're going to see the Pro.
We're going to see the Pro. Oh, by the way, it's an iPad and it's bigger and it has.
I think they're going to spend more time on that. I think they're going to I think the existing line is just going to be like the iMac and like the MacBook Pro line.
This is a thing. It's established. You use it or you don't. And this is what we're doing with it.
Yeah. I think the Pro they're going to spend some time on. I think you're going to see a lot of the time spent on the iPhone hardware and the TV. I think those are going to be the two big ones, followed up in third place by the new iPad Pro, not the Air 3.
Speaking of, the Force Touch is supposed to be a part of that. Mm-hmm. I was helping set up something the other day and I realized they got a new MacBook, and I was actually using the MacBook for a little bit, and then I realized, oh, this is the new MacBook
with Force Touch.
Oh, this is the one. And I did the little Force Touch thing, and I'm like, oh, and then I realized there's no button here. Remember that time when we were doing that thing here in the studio? That sounds weird. But when you're like, it's not a button, so I actually had to like take a moment and go boop, boop, you know. And it's just the guy that I was helping out had never used Mac before, so I decided not to blow his mind with that. So we'll get that this week.
I'm interested to see, because that's the other big thing is El Capitan actually implements capabilities with that. It's not Mm-hmm. There's really nothing, you can't do that much with it today. So right, I'll be interested to see how they do that. The one thing I want to see is on my notification screen, much like the watch, I want to be able to force touch to get rid of all of my pending notifications.
Watch 2.0 should be out soon as well. Probably some final notes on that.
So I think we'll see the iOS GA will launch tomorrow, right after, and then everybody else will see it. Non-developers and non-beta testers will see it the following Tuesday.
Katie, anything you're looking forward to out of this announcement?
Look. I would honestly, I would really like a new tablet.
Mm-hmm.
So I could be looking at that direction. I need to replace my MacBook, and I don't want to. But I don't think my... I need something between my MacBook and my tablet.
Right, exactly.
That makes sense.
Exactly. Well, the nice thing is, even if you got like the low-end MacBook Air, mm-hmm. it's plenty for what you do, I think. Mm-hmm. So you'd be fine
Would
with
Would you
that.
Consider a Chromebook?
Yes. We've had those conversations.
Oh, yes. Oh, yeah. And that, too. That would be great for mm-hmm. you. Chachi just picked one up, and he seems to be pretty happy with it.
Good.
And Chachi is hard to please.
I've heard that.
Awesome. So we'll be on the Twitters.
What are you looking forward to?
What am I looking forward to? I'm just let me know what my next phone is. I don't. And
tell me what I'm buying.
Yeah, exactly. That I don't know how I'm going to buy it, but it's time to upgrade. We're at that point. By the way, if anybody knows, I'm considering trying the AT&T Next plan. Tell me if that's a horrible, horrible idea or not. I don't want to do it to upgrade every year, though. I just want to do it so I don't have to drop a chunk of change for that phone.
I don't know what the next plan to.
That's like,
when
it's
I
like
go
the,
on
it's
the
like
Friday.
The edge
plan.
I mean, it's like
what's the cost differential, and that's what you have to decide.
Yeah, that's the thing. How much difference is it? I'm not going to go on the plan to trade the phone in at X time.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be no. I want to pay it off because I thought about that. I was this close to saying, you know what? We'll just do that. We'll just go ahead and do the upgrade every year, and then we have the new phone. But I like having the hand-me-downs, right? I like having that back one. I'm hoping I can hold on to one of these things and like Katie, like I did for the gathering,
mm-hmm.
just have one for video that I can set up and not worry about, throw an extra Periscope on the Wi-Fi, something like that. I like that idea of just owning the hardware. But I'm worrying about the payment plan. Does that make sense? Does it make sense on AT&T? I think you get a little bit of discount, but I think we only get it for the primary number holder. So I'm really, really considering it, but I kind of want to get anybody's thoughts there on the plan as well. So so that's the Awesomecast, guys. Thanks at Chilla on the Twitters.
That's where I'm at.
Sure you'll be watching the stream, commenting tomorrow, right?
Oh,
right.
Yeah.
Dutters at K Dutters on the Twitter.
Hi. Oh, I got all kinds of shenanigans this week.
Oh, geez. You're going to want to watch her Twitter and her Periscope, I'm guessing, over this weekend.
Yeah, I'll be at Wizard World. Friday, I'll be just an attendee. Saturday, Sunday, I'll be a little more in it. So with Scarehouse, so you'll be able to see me there. Little cosplay there.
And
a little horror crossover cosplay.
I think I am confirmed to be there Saturday.
Huh?
So I will be there with some video equipment. Mm-hmm. Yeah, at least one thing I have confirmed to film. I'm actually going to be filming a panel for our friends, the Comic Book Pit. Please go check out them, a great Pittsburgh podcast from guys that are doing comic books. They are independent comic book makers, and they have a long-standing podcast here in town. We've done some stuff at the old Pittsburgh Comic Con with them. If you go look up some old Sorgatron Media videos, some great stuff there.
I'll be there on Saturday afternoon, and I will be there Sunday morning because it's Kids Day,
and
Christopher's coming out. So.
Yay! Awesome. Isn't it awesome to have, like, it looks like it's a real con.
Yes.
In Pittsburgh. This is great.
David Duchovny is now appearing there on Saturday.
David Duchovny.
Yep.
Dean Cain. Well, Dean Cain was at the other thing, too, yeah, so let's Cain be honest about that. City. So
I'm a little bummed that Nathan Fillion canceled.
He
canceled Philly, too, so
bummed
me out, but it is what it is.
I'll let you know about Dean Ambrose.
I'm hoping I can sneak into the page Q&A or whatever's going on there. I don't know. Are those generally open or is those VIP only? Or is it VIP first, basically?
I think, yeah. VIP
first. Mm-hmm. So I could maybe squeeze into one of those.
Mm-hmm.
So, okay. Looking forward to that. We'll see what I can do. That's what I can do. So on that note, please check out everything awesomecast.net. Please, if you can, become our boss on patreon.com/awesomecast if you dig our stuff and want to contribute to that. Follow us on the Twitters, on the Facebook, in the Facebook group. And thank you to our awesome chat room, live.awesomecast.net tonight. I know Chachi's been in there. Juggalo John Wheels, a bunch of new faces. High Heel Garza, you've been in there a little early. That's cool. That's cool. So go check that out. If you're in there live, you can stick around for boss battle, talking some video games with the insertcointobegin.com crew. Thank you to our awesome chat room. Thank you, our awesome co-hosts on the couch hanging out. Hi. They're not paying any attention. They're like, no, the show's ending. I'm good.
Done.
You have been our awesome audience. Have an awesome week. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at sorgatronmedia.com.